Did anyone come last night, actually? Who was here last night? You saw the cut when you'd taken the mic off, which was which features Michael, actually, very briefly. And when we first heard about Nezisville quite a few years ago through some friends in Bristol, suggested we show it. And we showed Ted the mic, we just loved it so much, we kept passing around each other and showing it at festivals and kept watching it, kept coming back to it. So it means quite a lot to us when we kind of come across filmmakers that we sort of have a relationship with in terms of being able to even just do this, you know, show film for the first time. And it means a lot to us. We show films, you know, as they come through the distributors and stuff. And people approach us out of the blue and say, you want to show a film and stuff. But when we kind of, have this more longer term thing, you know, it does mean a lot to us. And it's great to welcome Ian back, especially Michael as well. I think something that we've travelled to come here tonight, but probably no one's travelled as far as Michael has. So it is a kind of Q&A, but you don't have to really ask any questions, you can just make comments and say things if you want. So I'm going to start off with a couple of questions to Ian, which is maybe just tell us a little bit about how you first met Michael and developed the kind of basis of this film.
Yeah, so it was, when we were making Taking the Mic, and sorry if people didn't watch it, the sort of main thing, the mode of transport in Taking the Mic is a pedal-powered Bond Reliant, which is like a Robin, a Bond Ranger, which is like a Robin Reliant. The original plan was that we had this shell of a Bond Ranger, and we were going to chop it in half, and it was going to be pulled by a horse down the journey of the film. So I was looking around for someone who kept horses or worked with horses, and Michael eventually, through various means, got in touch with Michael and said, is this a thing that it's possible, and he said, no, that's ridiculous. the horse will be crippled straight away.
Why, it could have made you comfortable.
Yeah. So that was sort of straight out the window, and the pedal power came in. But what happened was that we then, Michael was based in and around Cornwall. I think, were you travelling back or something?
Yeah, I was coming back down to Lafferty.
Yeah. And so we met on the edge of Bodmin Moor, and Michael took us across Bodmin Moor, which is in Taking the Michael. And after that experience, we just sort of talked and chatted about the idea that we would make something. And I think initially you were thinking that it would be just a kind of descriptive of your life. Mm. And some of the sort of techniques of working and travelling with horses. And then this just kind of came about. And
yeah. So it's over 5 year period. Is Tarantino, is he black and white, Tarantino?
Yeah.
Did that inform your decision to shoot it in black and white?
No, actually. No. I don't know, the black and white thing, it came about. It just seemed to make sense. I don't know why. Yeah. I guess like I've been Win Stanley. It's the film Win Stanley. Like the visual sense of that is like I've always been sort of blown away by that.
Yeah.
So that's the sort of touch point. That's the sort of what that makes. And it seemed to make sense.
So did you know, how often did you stay in contact during the 5 years, and you'd know where Michael would go and you'd go meet him and stuff? Was that kind of like going to happen at the last minute each time? You know, how much of a plan was there behind it?
It was only, like the filming all took place in 2014. So yeah. it's like a calendar year. And then since then, since 2014, I think we sort of just let it sit for a while, and then we started looking at it, and the editing sort of took the same process as the filmmaking, where we just wherever you were, so we met up in New York, we came up to Scotland. So we just sort of I'd go away and edit it, and then we'd meet up and have a look, and that's sort of
Is. And that the region in France, the Camargue, is that the area that's known for the white horses?
Yeah.
The grey horses.
Yeah.
Okay. I said in Ned's earlier that I bought a film, I kind of collect pieces of film, and I bought a film off eBay, a 16mm film, that's this film called The Dream of the Wild Horses.
Right.
And it's this kind of French film from the 70s, which is pictures of all dancing around the sea and stuff.
Yeah.
So I noticed that.
It's amazing when you pass through it, there's white horses everywhere.
Mm. Sort of. Yeah.
Did Tarantino, did he like travelling in the south of France?
Not particularly. He liked eating the French figs. He likes them when we can't eat them, when they're too hard. That's his sort of ideal.
Right.
I think he doesn't like the flies much. In the summer, the flies are really bad. So.
And it was windy. Non-stop.
Well, yeah, that was a bit of a disappointment. And it was quite tricky filming because it was blowing a gale. It was like being at Southend, not the Mediterranean. Or what I'd imagined, it was a pure blue sea and sky. And a few days later, it did come out nice, didn't it? But doing that bit of filming, it was quite a challenge to sort of sit on him, really, and be in the sea, and he wasn't that keen to go in. Sure, it looks a little bit scary, with the white horses and that, in the sea, the roughness of the sea.
Did you get him to swim?
Not that day. Another day, and he has swum in various other around the coast of England and in rivers. But it was really windy that day. It was difficult to even the sand was blowing all over the camera, wasn't it? Mm. Yeah.
Do you want to say a bit about how you travel and why you travel and why you end up going to the places that you do? Because I think it's all, there's a few people who travel around and have particular places that they go, but certainly during this the process of the film, you just seem to go.
Yes, I usually have some sort of reason, like I wanted to get a new pair of boots at Stirling Hall.
So you travelled from the south coast of France to Stirling
Hall? No, I did.
There just seem like there would be, you know, I was interested in those, like in Stirling Hall, those groups of people who meet up. There seem to be places where people with horses meet up.
Yeah, there are
like
a few
where that boy was.
Traditional
horse
fairs.
Is that how it works?
Yeah, there are a few traditional house fairs that still exist, and they're handy places to buy things that are peculiar to travelling with a horse. And, bits of harness and.
Are they kind of? Are they sort of on the edge of existence, really? Do you think they're kind of sort of dropping out of? I mean, obviously Appleby's huge, but when we were at Stowe, which was five years ago, that room sort of
dying out,
felt
really,
like it was,
yeah.
But it's still going.
It is still hanging on, yeah.
Do you think the lifestyle will disappear, or is there sort of resurgence of it?
Well, I don't know. I think a few people in the whole of Britain, there's probably about, I can only think of it, perhaps about 3 dozen people at the most.
Right.
So that's out of the 60 or 70 million people, isn't it? So if you do see a horse and wagon, you should be pleased, not fed up about it. Not fed up because you know some people are offended by it and shout abuse and often racist abuse and that. But, that's not so bad these days. I think people are getting there, but 20 years ago, people did shout a lot of abuse. Go past in cars. The funny thing is they'd often drive past and then they'd suddenly put their foot down and speed off as though you were going to chase after them. That was fairly cowardly. You know. They wouldn't get out of their car and come and
chase. Have you been living that sort of travelling life all of your life?
No, I haven't. I saw a man on the side of the road about 20 years ago. And I thought, oh, that's a life for me. Yeah, the first horse I got a grant through the European Community.
Did you know about horses before that?
No, I didn't. It was a big learning curve. But I put heart and soul into it. And then that's been a lovely, you know, making the wagons and training the horses, and I've had quite a few horses. And often I get given ones that have been spoiled by other people, and sometimes I can make something of those and find them good homes. And that's been a lovely part of the journey, really, is learning all those skills and how to do it, really. And becoming efficient at it, so that it's easy, it's not too arduous.
Because you train them on the road?
If you have to, it's not the ideal place, but they soon get used to traffic. Yeah.
Can anyone get a grant from the...
It's about a week, Charles.
in a poorer part of the country at the time, and there was money, and oddly they tend to be also parts of the country where people vote to leave, but they get the largest amount of grants.
Like
Cornwall. Which is odd for me. I think the money was well spent.
Do you meet many people on the road? Do they sort of approach you, or?
People come and talk to me all the time. Yeah, most I'd say 95% or something were really friendly, and you get a few that aren't friendly. But on the whole, it's a positive.
So where are you heading?
And at one moment, I'm heading up to Scotland. I've come up in Cornwall the last 2 weeks, and now the horse is in Taunton. And then by May, I'll be up in Cumbria. And the end of June, up in the Scottish Borders.
How many miles a day do you travel?
On average, about 12 miles a day, and that's really wide towns are about 12 miles apart on that on the whole, because it's sort of fairly easy walk. That the horse or human are capable of.
How do you get around the hills? Do you climb the
road? Yeah, I try and avoid the worst of the hills, especially hills with a lot of traffic on. I try and take little country lanes.
Do you sometimes kind of like take a road thinking
that'll look alright, and there's like, oh, the road
thinking that I'll have to go
back around? He's pretty good at getting up the hills. He's a good worker, and I don't have the kitchen.
How long did it take to get to South?
Well, I got to Calais in the beginning of February, and then 10 weeks later, I was down. I walked across France down to the canal, so not too long. And like I said in the thing, I'm always at home.
Yeah.
was that a particular adventure that you left the UK to do that? Journey, or is that
something? Yeah, I wanted a new hat. It did cost me about £500 on the ferry. I was there, I did stay there for 7 months, so it was worth the money.
What a
Tarantino
bill on the ferry.
Yeah, he went in a lorry, and then they dropped the lorry, dropped me off just outside Calais in a picnic area. And it was interesting meeting the refugees in Calais. And,
the wagon went
on a trailer, and that was really what cost the money, to actually put the horse in a lorry with a load of other horses. They were upset with cubicles, you know, the stalls on the lorry, but that doesn't really cost a lot of money. And the paperwork was at the time very simple, but I don't know whether that would still be simple if we were to leave the EU or something.
How many horses do you have?
Well, I've got
6 do you know? Do you have them all in your head? Do you have a map? Do you have ordnance
survey? Yeah, I do have maps, and the ordnance survey, like those sort of pink coloured ones, are good because they show all the streams, so you know you can water the horse.
And right. Do you have like 150 ordnance survey maps?
Yeah, I've got quite a lot. they're quite interesting to look at. There's a lot you can find out about areas before you even get there. You're just looking at the map. It is a bit of a nuisance because they take up space and weight. Yeah, you can do that, and I think some people are doing that nowadays, but I've already got the maps, really, and it seems not real.
You mark the routes?
Yeah, and I explore new bits of country every year and try and improve on the routes so that I go through the most scenic parts of the country, the most interesting.
Can I ask you about the experience of being filmed? Like, how did you? Have you enjoyed it?
Ambivalent feelings about it. I think anyone who sees himself on film is a bit shocked. When I first saw the bit of film at the beginning, I thought, who's that old bloke leading the horse? No, you look in the mirror each day, don't you? But you don't really quite see yourself quite the same way when you're on the film. Do you? So, you know, it's a little bit uncomfortable.
Was there any point where you thought that it wasn't going to happen? Like, over the last 5 years?
Oh, no, I had absolute faith.
As a filmmaker, was that a conscious decision on your part not to kind of talk to him much? Because it was only really right at the end when Michael was just sort of chatting about, wait, I thought he was talking to you when you were sitting on the wagon. Was that a conscious decision, like in cafes and things, to
like I was saying before, my interest really is in the sort of experience of, is kind of being immersed in the sort of experience of making the journey. So I don't mind sort of being, I didn't mind kind of it being obvious that I was there. But,
did you tell him not to talk to you?
Oh. No, I mean, you know, we were just, I suppose there was at points there was more dialogue in the film, and bit by bit we just removed it, and it just makes more sense. The logic of it, the kind of where you're kind of just immersed in the movement, the first section and the last section is a kind of there's a sort of arc, there's a sort of cyclical thing that goes on there where you know you kind of go back at the end. And then all the bits, the sort of different things that happen in different places in the four acts in the middle. So it was more about it was a lot more descriptive at points. Like there was a lot of stuff about what the festival was in San Marino there, and why we were there, and you know who it was for and all that sort of thing. And in the first section, you know, we did a long interview about the fact that Michael's going over the channel again to France, and where he's coming from, and the decision that he'd made to go over, and it just got taken out bit by bit because it really felt I think like for me I don't necessarily want to kind of guide you in that way. I think mystery in the kind of like you're sort of more engaged in some way. Maybe you're not really sure what's going on.
I really like the quiet bits where you just have the grass is blowing and like that. But how did you come up with the type of quiet resistance, and what was the rest of it?
Something acts of quiet.
Acts of quiet. Why did you come up with that? What does that mean?
Initially, it was something that I wrote for a sort of early edit of the film. I put it just from conversations I had with Michael, from my perspective, like Michael's quite vocal about the reason why he chooses that lifestyle, and it is an act of resistance to the kind of trappings of modern life, so I kind of initially put that in this bit of text, and you said, "Oh, I like that. That makes sense to me." And we were trolling around for titles for ages, and then I just kind of pulled that back out. And the film being in six acts.
It's sort of doing your own thing, but not really drawing attention to it. You're just getting on with it. What I want to do doesn't have to fit in and conform to what's sort of expected.
And I think in terms of the film, like if I'm trying to kind of visually portray Michael's life in quite a sort of
straightforward way, which I am trying to do. Then that's the thing that comes through strongly for me in how Michael lives his life and why he thinks about that. So yeah, it's kind of important to me for that to be there. And at the moment, you've got a big banner on the back of your wagon.
Oh yeah.
That says says climate crisis and it's a response to it. It's brilliant. Well done, David.
Can I ask you?
Yeah.
It feels like you like having your sense of what you call home close to you.
Yes.
A lot of the time.
Yes.
Have there been times in your life when you'd like not having what you feel like is your home?
When I haven't had the home.
Away from it, have you ever felt like you've enjoyed being further away from your sense of what is home?
Well, I mean, it's sort of
you talked at one point that was about a sense of kind of. You felt like you become institutionalised in your wagon.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Yeah, you do it so much. It's actually you forget how to get on a bus or something. You know, to you haven't done it for so long. I don't feel quite confident about it. So I think every so often it's good to try and come to Bristol.
Was there a question up there?
Yeah, I was just wondering how long did it take to sort of make that sort of change, that adjustment from your former life before you started going into the road?
Well, it was a big learning curve at the beginning and quite scary, really. But it's something that's a sort of ongoing process, really, and you know, each year I get a bit better at doing it. Really.
Your horse.
Yes.
Do you mind if I ask you how much it cost, and where you bought it from, and how would you know to buy a good horse to leave your cart or your wagon?
Well, it's a bit of a minefield like buying a second-hand car in the dark. a cob to pull a wagon, you need about £3,000 these days. But it's a bit like how long's a ball of string, there's so many variables, and you might get given one.
You did mention in the film that you'd, either thing were for sale, so maybe you make the right offer.
Yeah. Did you buy him an Appleby?
No, I didn't buy him an Appleby. I bought him off a farmer that ran him with his mares down in Cornwall as a two-year-old. Mm-hmm. And then I trained him and did it like that. That's the cheapest way to get a horse, is to buy a young one and train it yourself. And also, then you can only blame yourself for the mistakes. Whereas if you buy a horse that's been trained by someone else, you're buying their mistakes.
He's got any, I mean, it strikes me, I don't know, great thing about horses, but it strikes me that he's got an amazing temper.
Yeah, and for a horse that's, you know, it's on the extremes of what you can do with a horse. You know, he's been through London, across Tower Bridge, and you could see in that film on the ferry, going across the middle of the ferry, that not every horse is going to have the temperament to be able to cope with that sort of thing, really. And it does take quite a bit of training, and lots of, once you've trained them, then they need lots and lots of practice at it, which he's had, you know, he's done about 15,000 miles. Yeah, but not every horse that's gone through my hands has been a success. It's a bit like, you know, a class of little children. They're all going to be at different levels, and some of them will be... You, with a horse, you want to choose the ones that are putting their hands up and saying, pick me, pick me, rather than the ones that really don't want to do it. There's, you know, it's like people, there's a lot of horses that don't really want to do running. Yeah, you've got to try and find something else, so you have to do a good one.
Michael, do you know the weight, the sort of weight of your wagon when it's loaded?
Yeah, I do. An empty wagon, I don't like them to weigh more than half a ton.
Wow.
And then I try and keep my stuff down to about 200 kilos. That's with my tools, okay, and my bagpipes, things to earn a living. Then I need tools for shoeing the horse. And I don't have to do it myself. So it all adds up, and clothes and bedding.
Yeah.
So you don't want it to weigh more than 3/4 of a ton if you can help it.
Yeah, okay. And what, have you ever got it sort of stuck? You have to, you can self-extract from muddy fields? And
yeah, no, I've never got stuck. And I've never been stuck on a hill.
Uh-huh. And is it brakes when you come down a hill?
Yeah, you do really need brakes to take the weight off the horse when you're coming down a hill. Otherwise, it's a real struggle on a steep hill for the horse, and not really fair to it. So if you've got good brakes, you can have a rest going down the hill, so you haven't really got to do much.
I've got a question about editing. Yes. I'm not confident that I've remembered it correctly, so maybe I'm wrong. But I really enjoyed the reflection, just giving some feedback, about the fact that you didn't do the more stereotypical type of documentary style where you did, like, you know, I really enjoyed that you held back on all of that footage that you were talking about earlier that you haven't really shown, because I felt it was more in keeping for the lifestyle that we were then learning about. But from my understanding, the first thing that a human said in the film was "shut up," somebody shouting at some dogs barking, and I wondered,
oh, yeah,
how much that, if that was actually maybe the first thing that somebody said, and if that was a purposeful edit, because I really enjoyed that, because it kind of added to that, what, you know, that idea of quieter and looking at the landscape,
right, yeah,
more. But I don't know.
It's not deliberate,
okay,
but it might be next time somewhere else.
Yeah.
yeah, there was lots of conversation between Michael and Mick, who owns the scrapyard there. But was taken out. It was, you know,
yeah.
Yeah. We sort of started with everything and then just sort of pulled it all out,
yeah,
and got this.
And it wasn't, I didn't seem to be very important, any of the dialogue.
Oh, yeah, no, it wasn't actually in the scrapyard. It was way later on.
Like at
on
the horse fair,
yeah,
and that,
yeah,
there's various conversations going on, and most of it's not,
yeah,
very relevant, in a way.
I think if it had been me, I think I wouldn't have had the sort of, I think I would have kept more dialogue in. But it was you that kept saying, no, take it out, take it out.
Yeah.
And actually with Leon as well. Yeah. Do you remember this? Leon gave us some
right
feedback.
Right, yeah, that was good.
Ask about your collaboration, because for you as a filmmaker, and you said it's really important to make films be sort of, I don't know, ethical practice based, so you collaborate with people.
Yeah.
So it seems to you as a filmmaker that it seems quite normal to engage with a subject, but for you, your life seems quite, if there's you and the wagon and the horse and you travel through different things, that having a filmmaker with you a lot of the time seems quite a big jump.
Yeah.
So I wondered how that.
Nez is very congenial.
Yeah, I think we would have had to like each other.
But I sort of wondered, because you said about getting institutionalised,
yes,
about being in a wagon,
yes,
but also wanting not to be a conformist. And you've chosen a sort of style.
Yes.
You know, there's a long tradition of horse and wagon, and
yes,
you've got a traditional car, and but then you've sort of broken it to have a filmmaker in there. and it's been a room full of people talking about it.
Yes.
So I just sort of, I'm interested how conscious that is. If you talk about
that. I'm picking my nails a little bit. I think we've got, most of us have got ambivalent feelings about mixing with people, and but also having solitude, and you can have too much of either. Really.
But also, it just, you, and this goes back to the sort of quiet resistance thing as well, I think, you want people to know about how you live, and you want, there's a sense in which you want to sort of teach people, and you want to sort of show that this is like the way of life that's possible.
Yeah, there are possibilities, and when I'm travelling, hardly a day goes past without someone saying, oh, I'd love to be doing that for free or something. And really, it's only ourselves, I think, that's stopping us. But it does take a bit of a leap. Like I said, when I first started doing it, it was pretty scary.
When you first started doing it, did you imagine you'd do it so long?
I thought this is a life for me. And I think quite a few people who in the beginning have that idea quickly realise it isn't a life for them. it suited the skills I already had, you know, making things and playing my bagpipes. And also, the lovely thing is I can practice my bagpipes without really bothering about the neighbours or anything. Which is a problem if you play, well, any musical instrument. Really. You can mow your lawn for 4 hours and make a lot of noise, but if you practice your clarinet or something, the neighbours will start banging on the walls.
How much of your journey is paced by your energy and how much by Tarantino's energy?
Well, some days are tough for both of us if we can't find a good place to stop. We might have to do more miles than we'd perhaps be comfortable. But then other days are easier, so it sort of evens out. But like I said, if you can do about 12 miles a day, that's comfortable for the horse and for the people.
Are you walking the whole way, or are you riding in the wagon?
If he's walking, I walk, and some days I just walk, but if I've got to go down a busy bit of dual carriageway or something, I'll trot just to get it over with quicker, and then I'll ride up. We did do about 8 miles an hour through Taunton yesterday. Normally I do about 2.5 miles.
I wondered how important the sense of community with other people living a similar lifestyle was. Do you meet up with other people living a similar way, as you need to, or is it, do you have a sense of community with other people?
Not very much, no. I tend to travel with other people. I like the freedom for me to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning in June, when the days are long. And just going, and if you travel with other people, you've got to negotiate. They've got to walk a wagon as well, and a horse, and then you've got the problems of finding more grazing. And so it's much freer, really, to be just one wagon and one horse. And also, less of a threat to the public. When there's a larger group, people become perhaps a bit more intimidated.
I was just really, the thing that chimed that stood out was the going towards nothing.
Yes.
That you said.
Yes.
And how it related to quiet resistance and notions of the going towards nothing. And that I think that I'm kind of trained in always going towards something.
Yeah.
That really kind of stood out for me in the way you made. what how does it feel to go towards nothing rather than towards something? Like the idea of taking the hiding home.
Oh.
Shot it in, because there's no pan. I don't know the technical word, but there's no sort of panning shots. It seems to be locked up on a tripod all the time.
Yeah.
Is that a conscious decision to just take a?
Yeah, I mean, there's
and
a certain.
And,
I mean, there's quite sort of strict boundaries in some way. I mean, there's a lot of points where that's not the case, but. That's just kind of how I've developed a sort of style.
Because even on the wagon, it seemed like
locked
off on it. I really like that. There wasn't any sort of panning and moving around. Zooming in and out or anything. It was just kind of pictures, solid frames.
Well, the whole thing is shot with the same lens as well. Like it's just like a DSLR, and like I have to build my filming equipment around being as portable as possible, because like quite often what I'm doing is traveling with it in ways where it has to be.
Everything on a tripod.
Sorry?
Everything on a tripod? You always had it handheld?
No, I just. I've actually. The last thing that I'm doing, I'm not struggling at all, consciously, just to push that side. Because it can be a bit of a crutch as well. Mm. You know, like when you sort of shoot everything.
Yeah.
From a tripod, it has advantages, and then but it gets to the point where there might be like a bit of wind that rocks the tripod, and you just start footage because of that. I sort of don't want to drive myself into that.
How much stuff is on the cutting room floor, so to speak?
I think there's about 50 hours of footage for this. That's about standard, I think, for like hours and things. I mean, it's even not that much. I try and be quite sparing with what I shoot, because coming from when you use film cameras, it's a good thing. Like more about you kind of. Which I don't use, but you're having to be really conscious of the seconds that you're using. So I've kind of got that in my mind, even though I don't.
Is there anything that you've noticed, like changing, like in climate change in the 20 years that you've done that? Things that you've noticed or insects or.
I think the weather patterns are changing, and less insects and odd little things. Not to pin it down, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it was noticeable, like going and you're often looking out into the field or into the
yes.
Like you're really observing everything, so you must have a little eye on what's changing, especially if you revisit.
Yeah, and human eyes are really designed to go at about 2.5 miles an hour. That's not the speed of a car. You know, they're designed for picking berries and that type of thing. So you do notice a lot. But you'd be astonished how much you do notice. You go up a road 100 times in a car and not see very much. And you'll see the senses of hearing and smell are quite often in a car.
Do you record it at all? Do you keep a diary or film?
Yeah, I keep a diary every day of how many miles I do and that helps me judge how well the shoes are lasting, and then I can make improvements.
But your shoes?
Yeah, mainly the horses, but yeah, finding a comfortable pair of shoes isn't that easy. But for me, you know, they do wear out.
I wondered how much your experiences of travelling so long have changed you as a person, or did you feel like you're more or less the same person you always were, but just more chilled and less hassle?
It's difficult to know what you'd be like in a different part. I think working with the horses and training them is a very positive thing. You can't really, there's not really any place for your ego if you're training the horse. Is there? you start getting angry with it, then you have to take a break or something.
Do you wish you'd stop doing this earlier in life?
No, not really. I don't have any particular regrets.
I've got a terrible question. you're a deep thinker, and I just wonder how you think society should change. Because you're on the road, you're thinking, and you're looking at life a lot,
yeah,
and observing, which is amazing to see. You don't have to answer. How do you think society should change?
could get rid of cars and start home and grow vegetables or something, and enjoy what's around you. You know, there's not really a lot of need to go off on exotic holidays when you've got exotic. You know, just within a few hundred yards of here, there'll be some wonderful places. Just within a few hundred yards of here, you know, you'd see some wonderful things. You must have seen them yourselves. Sorry. High five.
Anyone else got any?
If you don't mind taking the mic, was that shown at many festivals, and what kind of response did you have?
It wasn't really. No, it's like my work doesn't really. It's too sort of documentary, because I'm a visual artist as well as sort of being. And so what I do tends to kind of fall in between gaps. So it's kind of too offbeat really for documentary festivals, apart from sort of maybe, you know, ones that sort of a bit more interested in artist film. The Cube is the place where it's been most sort of loved really. And it was shown by, it was shown around a few festivals.
It just seems like it could be a huge film. It's a bit like, I was talking to Chiz yesterday, and it seemed to me like it was on a level with Weird Nail and I. It just had a little bit more something or other. It seems to be that it could be massive because it's so humorous.
Well, there's like, people really enjoy it, but I think it's just a level of, you know, I don't think it's ever going to be, like, it's not very well made. Like, as a filmmaker, I can look at that, like, 7 years later and think, that's quite amateurish, actually.
Is that part of the charm, man?
Yeah, for sure.
But
yeah.
Part of how I design.
But yeah, I think, like, I was pleased in a way seeing it last night, because I haven't watched it for about 5 years. So I was pleased that it still feels current. It doesn't feel sort of dated, and it doesn't feel like the things that are happening in it are being talked about in it. And lots of people, like individuals, come up to me, like, I mean, not out of the blue, not in the street, but people who
who've seen it through the sort of various networks that it's gone out in, like, really want to tell me how much they've enjoyed it, and that's great. Like, and that sort of never stopped happening. But no, like in sort of film circles, in those kind of more the sort of documentary, it wasn't. No one's really interested. I mean, I didn't really push it that much either, because I really hate that side of it. I can't be honest with it.
We're going to show another one of Les's films last year, actually, Settlers in England, which is available here in DVD. We cancelled it in the end because there was a concert planned with a musician that. Did he contribute music to it, or did he just sort of linked?
He wanted to tour with that film because his work. It's a musician called Jim Gedding who made a film about the kind of the North Nottinghamshire and South Yorkshire, where the bit sort of ex-mining village where he's from, and that's where Settlers in England was made as well. And his work is, the album is called A Hymn to Ancient Land, so he's like that's what he makes work of that as well.
We had to cancel that because Jim's got his pressings back for his records and they weren't good enough, so he cancelled the whole tour. He didn't show it, but I thought that was a very interesting film. And what, in terms of your subjects, do they kind of find you, or do you seek out things like that? That's more of a conventional type of documentary, isn't it, about this place which Les will tell you about? Kind of a sort of
well, that's a commission. Like these, like Taking the Michael and they're just films that they've just been made. They're unfunded, really. Yeah. Whereas that was a response to a kind of a brief, which was to work with people in the area from a sort of local arts organisation. Settlers in England is about a. What was something called the Land Settlement Association, which was a scheme in the 30s that the government put former soldiers mainly back onto and miners and bought all of these plots of land but yeah, it's so they're like market gardeners. So they've all got a piggery, 4 acres, and a little house attached to it. And so the people that I was making the film about were generally the people in their 80s who were the children of those original settlers. But yeah, I'm not sure what I'm talking about.
They all still live there.
Okay, have you got any questions? Just quickly from Michael. About the metalworking and the craftsmanship, where did you acquire those skills? Was it before you started travelling?
I went trained to make musical instruments. Originally, and then I did that for a bit. Over the years, I've gradually acquired skills that. When you travel with a horse, you've got to keep the weight down so you can't have too much equipment. So, really, what I make. And do it's dictated by what a horse can pull sensibly.
Did you make your own bagpipes?
Yeah.
Brilliant.
I like that first statement in the film. It's almost like Zen koans.
Yeah.
I just wondered if you could comment on that context of the film.
Yeah, so Basho, Katsu Basho, was a 16th century. Japanese poet who spent his life repeatedly just setting off on journeys, like being a little behind and setting off, and all of his work is about that, and this like series of journeys that he took, like a journey to the to the far north, and they're all these amazing walking. I told Mike about it at some point because I was reading the sort of anthology of everything he wrote. And it kind of chimes with me, for me a bit with what Michael does and the way that he approaches is like. So then I found that quote. It was just in. I can't remember which one, but yeah, one of his. I think it was like Journeys. Something he wrote something. Recollections of an exposed skeleton. And I think it's in that.
Can you remind us of the quote?
So it's before enlightenment, chopping wood and fetching water. After enlightenment, chopping wood and fetching water. It's great, and it's just kind of And Michael spends a lot of time in the film chopping wood and fetching wood.
He certainly seems like an enlightened fellow, if you don't mind my saying so much.
Shall we repair?
Let's say thanks again to Michael and Lou.
Please hang around with us.